Hello there, my Biology 111. I am your teacher, Vanessa Aragon. We've talked ever so much. So this video is to help you understand what the scientific method is and the application of it. I could just give you a scientific method video and have you watch it, but I thought you might like the opportunity to get to know me and what I like to do for scientific method. So with a scientific method, if you noticed on your discussion board, I have on there about being a baby scientist. And then when it comes to the responses, I'm like, oh, I'm a big scientist now. I'm a grown-up scientist. Mainly because the first thing that happens when I ask my class, when I'm in class, I say, who thinks that they're scientists? I usually get like hands like, nobody's looking around. I might have a couple people that, yeah, I am. So I'm here to tell you that you are all scientists. We are all scientists. My dog's a scientist. I'm not comparing you to my dog. But we use a scientific method. Animals use a scientific method. They don't think about it. It's like trial and error. And then they figure it out. So the point to tell you is you are all scientists. And I want you to have the confidence going into this that you are a scientist. So I'm going to work you through something that is called the scientific method. A lot of times students don't even realize that they were ever participants in the scientific method. But by the time you get done with this talk, you are going to realize that, oh, yeah, that's me. Okay, so with the scientific method, it's a series of steps that we go through in order to identify the natural world. And basically, we start to ask questions about the natural world. We do this all the time. I go hiking, and I'm like, oh my gosh, look at that. Oh, look at this. Oh, look at that. Or I'll see animals outside. Oh my gosh, look at that baby. Oh, where's his mommy? You're making observations of the natural world. Okay. And that's what we naturally do. And then, so from there, we start asking questions about that natural world. And so that is, I forgot to put observation on my list. By the way, when you look on the internet and you look for the scientific method flowchart, none of them are the same. None of them. I can't find the perfect one. I just need to make the perfect one because I incorporate them from everywhere. So don't get caught up in, oh, Mrs. Aragon said it like this, but they don't put that in theirs. It's all right. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and give you what I think. So have what I think, what I know, what I practice. All righty. So I'm going to go ahead and add one more step up in here. And so, because it's a hugely important step. Okay. And hopefully this doesn't get too busy looking for you. You could always pause the video and zoom in. All right, so here's my flow chart of the scientific method. Like I told you, none of them are perfect. None of them are all the same. I don't think I found one that had everything in it, except for the one that I just made. All right, so the first thing it says, make observation. So like I just told you, we make observations of the natural world. We do that using our senses. We do that using our sight, our hearing, our smell, our taste, our touch. So we use all of our senses in order to make those observations. All right, so from those observations, that leads us to ask questions. You know, I'm out there looking at the baby bunny rabbit, and in my mind, I'm thinking, I'm making an observation of the natural world with my eyes. He, by the way, did not even flinch when my husband and I walked by, okay? Baby bunny rabbit didn't flinch. All of a sudden, I'm formulating questions in my head. I wonder if he has not even had that experience to know that he should be running, because he was just eating. He was just eating and looking at us. So for him, his nutrition was more important than running. So it makes me think to question, he must be pretty young. Maybe he hasn't experienced that. And then I'm also looking around and making questions. Well, where's his mom? Using more observation to make more questions and so forth. Alrighty, so do background research, okay? So as we make our observations and formulate questions, we should be really good about this, doing the background research. All of a sudden, you get on the internet, boom, boom, boom. What's that about? That's what we do all the time. We do background research because you might find that other people have the same questions. You might find that other scientists have gone through this process already and already formulated experiments. Okay, so with that background research, if you notice in your discussion board, I have some stipulations on what that research looks like, okay, in the responses part. What is good research? We want to make sure we're using sites that are .edu, okay, .org, using TED-Ed sites. If you use YouTube videos, that's fine, but think about reputable YouTube videos. What is reputable? Khan Academy, using Bozeman Science. He's an excellent teacher. He's an excellent reference. I put stuff up with him all the time. Using publishers, you know, using science sites that are real science sites. Okay, so sometimes you got to do a little bit digging and see what they're about. And so here's what I won't allow. Wiki, okay? Wikipedia is a big no. .coms are a little iffy. If it's a decent site, it will be an organization. And even the orgs can be a little iffy sometimes. It just really depends, okay? But I'll accept orgs, okay? I don't expect you to. But if you were doing thesis work, you would not even be working in any of those. You would, well, you might a little bit, but that would not be your main bulk. You would be in Google Scholar looking for papers, and those papers are papers that scientists have put out and they have published to their peers, and it takes a lot to go through publishing. So that is ultra reputable. I don't expect you to do that for a 15-point discussion board, okay? All right, so let's get back, do your research. Once you've done your research from your observation, from your question, some background research, you can construct a hypothesis, okay? And a hypothesis, what a hypothesis is, here you go. It is a tentative answer to a well-framed question. That's what a hypothesis is. Now, I'm not going to get into null hypothesis or alternate hypothesis and so forth. In this class, if you have that experience, that's awesome. In this class, we're going to make it simple, okay? I'm going to tell you your best hypothesis is going to be one that is an if-then statement. If blank, 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 then blank, 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 period. It shows cause and effect. If this, then that. I would write it on my board, but I don't have another board. So if-then statements. If you can work out a hypothesis without doing an if-then statement, that's fine. I'll still accept it. But if you don't want to fumble around with trying to make a hypothesis, use an if-then statement. That'll make it easy. So it is a tentative answer to a well-framed question. Alrighty, so with that, once you have your hypothesis, you're going to design experiments to test the hypothesis. Now, we have to be really careful about not doing backward science, okay? We don't want to design experiments, get results, and then go back and formulate a hypothesis. That's backward science. You always have to formulate your hypothesis before you do anything, okay? So that's the big important thing. So you design your experiment to test your hypothesis, and then from there you get some results, some data and results. So you're going to analyze that data and draw conclusions, okay? So with that, does your data support your hypothesis? If it does not, I'm sorry, let's say it does. Let's go the easy way first. Say it does support your hypothesis. That's great. You did it first time out the gate. Yeah, I doubt it. So anyway, hypothesis supported. That was not a dig on you. That was a dig on all scientists. So hypothesis, it says hypo, in case you can't read the board from the video. Hypothesis supported. Report your results. send it off to peers, see if you can get published, send it to other scientists. Maybe the other scientists want to go ahead and test your hypothesis. Maybe they do the exact same experiment to test the hypothesis, or maybe they design their own experiment to test your hypothesis, okay? So that's great, doesn't happen all the time. Most of the time, we'll see. And when you analyze your data, either your hypothesis could be partially supported. You might want to report that. That might be another arrow going down, report it. Or if it's not supported, which means you got to try again. See, I even wrote here. It says, try again. So you're going to go back to the drawing board. Now, this is where you're going to start to see the fluidity of this flowchart. Because, yes, I put try again, reconstruct that hypothesis. Maybe you do that. But maybe it wasn't the hypothesis that was a problem. Maybe it was your experiment that's a problem. So maybe instead of your data, go back once you maybe reconstruct your experiment and see what happens. So it's not always about the hypothesis. So it's very fluid. And so if I get to that point where I get to report my results, other scientists can come in, they can read my paper, they can go ahead and use my hypothesis and see if they can design their own experiments also, and maybe other alternate experiments, several different experiments to see if we can nullify. Nullify means actually prove it wrong, okay? So with that, I want to go ahead and tell you, when you look at some of these flow charts, sometimes it'll say, instead of, you notice I put not supported, okay, and supported. Sometimes it'll say proven true. I'll be honest with you, I learned this a long time ago in my scientific career. You can never prove anything true. You cannot prove gravity true. I'm not going to drop my marker because I don't want to chase it around. Here's my little sock I've been using to clean my board. Boom, gravity. Gravity's way past the hypothesis. It's way past a theory. It's a law. So which means we've yet to disprove it. But you cannot prove anything true. We just keep supporting it over and over and over and over again. Okay? Alrighty. So sorry about that. That's my dogs. So I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to give you an example, a real world example, because on your discussion, I had said, I want you to give me an example in the class, an example of where you have illustrated the scientific method. Now you might be thinking, oh, I was in science class and oh, I did this. No, I want to know, in your everyday life, how have you illustrated the scientific method? Okay. I wish I could find a way to keep this up. I don't have anything to keep it up. Well, I'll just pick it up when I need it, okay? So I'm gonna use my famous cookie example with the two-year-olds, okay? Many of you have young children. Many of you have old children, but you remember when they were young. Many of you don't have children, but you were a child, so you can get with this, all right? So little two-year-old, if you know anything about two-year-olds, they're crazy smart. They're constantly looking around. They're constantly making observations with their eyes, with their ears, with their nose, with their mouth, constantly making observations. So that's what they're doing, using their senses to make observations. So two-year-old comes in. That two-year-old comes in to the kitchen and they see mom has just been to Costco or Sam's. You can go either way. And what you get from Costco or Sam's is a big packet of cookies, okay? They made an observation. They see that packet of cookies. The next thing on that list is to formulate a question, ask a question. In this two-year-old's mind, you know, they're not talking to their mom about it yet because they've learned some things about their mom or their dad maybe. They're like, how can I get those cookies? Okay. How can I get those cookies? Make observation. There's cookies. How can I get the cookies? That's the ask a question. Do some background research. Okay. Well, they're two. I don't know. They might be on the internet, but their general background research is going to be in their brain. They're going to remember the time when this happened before and they begged for cookies and it didn't come out the way they wanted. Okay, that's their background research. So they do their background research, and then they're going to, because of observation, ask that question, how can I get the cookies? Background research, well, I sure ain't going to ask her, because they know that's going to turn out a no, which hers, their mother or their father, him, or they, construct hypothesis. So they're going to construct a hypothesis. Now I'm going to state it in that if-then fashion, okay? If I can get on top of that counter, then I could get some cookies because mom put the cookies on the counter. Simple if-then statement, cause and effect. If I can get on top of the counter, then I can get the cookies. That's the hypothesis. Now, next thing you're going to do, mom left the room, they're going to test that hypothesis. So being that they're two, they're going to start with the most simplistic test first. Remember, this is their first time. The next time they won't, they'll know exactly what to do. First time, they walk up to the counter. Counter's kind of high, two down here. They're like, nope, okay. That was their experiment. They tested their hypothesis of if I can get on the counter, then I can get the cookies. With the experiment of walking up to the counter and reaching as hard as they could. And so then they got data. That data did not support their hypothesis. They didn't get the cookies. So back to the drawing board, and they're going to reformulate their hypothesis. They're going to say, if I can climb up on the drawers, then I can get on the counter to get the cookies. So that's what two-year-olds do. That's why you got to have drawer locks, especially on your credenzas and everything. Credenza, that's such an old-fashioned word. So what they do, they step on the drawers in the kitchen, and they get a little higher, and they get a little higher, right? And those drawers are sliding out and everything, and they just can't get to it. That was their experiment. They have to go back to the drawing board because their hypothesis of if they can climb up and get to the counter, then they can get the cookies was not supported. Back to the drawing board. Reconstruct your hypothesis. Next, they're figuring it out because that's how two-year-olds are. If I get this chair, slide it up, just like the two-year-olds do, right? Climb on it. Wait, I can't do the experiment yet. Got to think in the head first. Hypothesis. If I push the chair up and climb on it, then I can reach the cookies. All right, now experiment. Yeah? Experiment. Reach. Boom. I don't know if I'm out of sight here, but I'm getting cookies. Okay? Now, my hypothesis has been supported. I can report my results. So as a two-year-old report his results. When his friends come over, he shows them how to do it. Exactly. That's how he reports the results. And then now, because he's done that background research, because he has collected data and figured out how to support that hypothesis, he'll never start from the beginning again. He'll continue with the experiment that always works. So that is how little two-year-olds are baby scientists, and they grow up to be big scientists. So as you go to do your discussion board, I want you to give me some real world examples, okay? But here's the deal. I want to see every single step. I want you to tell me every single step, okay? I don't want to go back and be like, what about this step? What about this step? Don't just give me a paragraph of where you think. I want you to tell me your observations, your questions, your background research, if applicable, not always applicable, right? Hypothesis, you got to have a hypothesis, okay? So I want you to be very specific in when you did that. And you can give me an overall synopsis of what happened, but I want to make sure that you tell me all of your steps. So I hope you've enjoyed this video, and I hope you have fun with this discussion board.